All right, welcome to A Friday Reads, where I talk about what I've read, what I'm reading, what I hope to get to next, and what did I buy from the bookstore this week. I swear, it's going to slow down. I mean, I know no one out there cares. I just, I'm surrounded by books. It's a problem, but I'm really happy with my book acquisitions. Only one of them is actually like on my physical TBR. The rest are more like my collector heart needed these things, so that helps me a little bit. But what have I finished? So basically, after I filmed last week, I picked up Migrations and finished it that night. Yeah, this book I just could not put down. So like I said last week, this is the story of a woman who's going to follow potentially the last migration of these Arctic terns from the Arctic Ocean to Antarctica. And there's just definitely more to this woman. Her name is Franny. She's half Irish, half Australian, and she has a very complicated family history that she's trying to parse, and you kind of follow her in this non-linear way through present day, where she's trying to follow this migration by convincing these fishermen to take her along, but also her past when she finds her husband, her searching for the rest of her family. There are many migrations, hence the title Migrations, and it was so good. We just had book club discussion this week. Everyone agreed that it just was so beautiful and captivating. The way it's able to be that beautiful, but also like have these moments of tension and be kind of like this thriller. It was so good. I had such a good time with this. We on average rated it like a 4.5 star. And I think that's actually what like my rating is. We do whole stars for book club. So I rated it 5 at book club, but my actual rating is like 4.5 stars. It was phenomenal and pretty short. So yeah, there's another book that came out just by this author that someone told me they think is even better. So when that is available in like paperback or something, I might try it out, or maybe I'll take it from the library, because I really liked the writing style, the narrative devices. It was all very engaging. Had a great time. The next one is The Inheritance of Orquídea Divina by Zoraida Córdova. I finally finished this one. I have a review going up on Sunday, so I'm going to try and be brief because I have all my spoiler-free thoughts already going to happen on this channel. But if you don't like watching reviews, I really liked this. There's some parts of the plot that made it unable to be like the 4.5 or 5 star experience that I need, but like it was still so solid. The character work, the family dynamics, the like tension and atmosphere. It's such a good fall book. I would really pick it up. And it's also pretty short. It's like 330 pages, I think, in this edition, maybe 20 some. I had a really great time. Zoraida Córdova is just like one of my autobuy authors now. Will buy anything she writes. I have now read 3 of her works, and I have really enjoyed all of them. So if you want to know my spoiler-free thoughts, check out that review. We also have a channel in my Discord where we've been sort of buddy reading it together, and that's been fun. And I actually accidentally buddy read this with Leanna from Leanna's Library, and that was really interesting, hearing the things that worked and didn't work for us. Like, the things that didn't work for her didn't necessarily not work for me, but there were other things that didn't work for me. But we both agree it was, like, really well-written and a good book. And so I am excited that it's in the universe for everyone to read. It's a really nice new release. I'm glad it lived up to my expectations. And now, what am I in the middle of? Okay, so I'm very excited about this. I'm so excited to be done with all of the work I have to do to get back to this book. And that is Symbiosis by Nicky Drayden. This is the second book after Escaping Exodus. I am like this far, so I only have like this much left. Nicky Drayden can do no wrong for me and what I like when I read a story. I was very nervous picking this up because a bunch of my friends rated it 3, 3.5, low 4 stars, and were saying they didn't like it as much as Escaping Exodus. I was really nervous. As of now, I love it just as much, if not more, than Escaping Exodus. I cannot wait to finish it and film my series review to get more of you guys to pick this up, because I think it is really fun. I really like it. I didn't know, like, I knew what to expect based off the name and what happened at the end of Escaping Exodus, but I didn't know how it would be done, and I'm really loving the execution. That said, who knows what'll happen with the ending. The weakest parts for me for Nicky Drayden books have been endings, but I don't know. I'm optimistic. I'm really curious. So I feel like I talk about this enough, but this is far future sci-fi where humans now live on these space beasts and kind of take over their bodies for their ends. And the first book explores, is that a sufficient system? You know, are there other ways we could be living because of complications and things like that? And it has a really fascinating social structure. and great characters and great banter, and it's so good. It's perfect for me, who loves good world building and great characters, and just it's also like asking like questions in the way that they answer them. It's enjoyable, it's thematically rich, the cover's totally worth the cover buys. I really like these books. So yeah, you know, like Zoraida Córdova, Nicky Drayden, autobuy author. I also did start my reread of Hyperion, which I forgot to mention in my TBR. I did put in the description, but I know not everyone reads those. I am reading this to be a book club host for the Shelf Space Book Club with Alan from the Library of Alexandria. We are reading Hyperion. This is the second time for both of us, but we both read it a very long time ago and don't remember much. And we both read it when we were kind of novices at the whole like reading sci-fi thing. And I'm enjoying it. I'm really excited. I am not that far, mainly because I've been reading the Kindle before bed, and I usually only can read like 20 pages or so before I fall asleep. And this is dense writing. That has not changed. My understanding of certain techniques in hard sci-fi make me feel a little more confident, but his writing style is still just like expecting more of my vocabulary than I want it to. Which is not the book's fault, but sometimes I feel like he goes out of his way to find the most obscure word to describe a thing, which is his right as an author, but like as a communicator, as someone who values my ability to communicate to others, specifically in science, but also here on BookTube with people. Like, I'm not here to say my grammar is very good or that I'm a good writer, but I think when you use a vocabulary word that only a certain subset of the population knows, it's not a great form of communication. And like the example is like in the prologue, we're on this planet and like what's happening on this planet is kind of cool, like what's being observed by a character. But like, unless you know certain words, you don't know that. I don't know. I think that's why both my first time reading this and probably this time, this is going to only be a 4-star read, because I love the ideas and it's a really great setup to a series that I really love. Like, I really like the following books in this series, but I rated this 4 stars the first time. And I think some of its choices for pacing and its choice of vocabulary is part of that. Just not to my like taste. I don't like to work that hard, okay? And luckily this time I'm reading it on Kindle so I can like tap words and know what they mean. But when you're reading a physical book, like, I don't have a dictionary next to me at all times. I don't know. Maybe everyone has a better vocabulary than me, but I get annoyed by those sort of things. But if you didn't know, Hyperion is about a group of pilgrims who don't know why, but the Temple of the Shrike has selected them to go on this pilgrimage at Hyperion. And normally what happens on this pilgrimage is one person gets to have their wish granted and I think the rest die. I'm unsure, like I said, really early on this reread, and most people don't understand how this planet works or the Shrike works anyways. And on that voyage, people are like, you know, it might be good if we got to know each other, you know, told our stories, maybe we'll understand things. So each pilgrim on this journey will tell its story, and at the same time, there might be a galactic battle above their head. That is foreshadowed in this prologue. So that's kind of the setting of this. It's classic sci-fi. I mean, it was written in the late 80s, so you decide when classic happens. I like it. I do love this cover. I think it's so cool. I wish I had, like, a taller version of it, but I only have the mass market paperbacks. So those are some things I'm reading. I'm sure I'm forgetting other things to talk about. Yes, I'm not that much further, but I'm still reading House of Chains. I'm really interested now because a thing happened. So, per usual, in a Malazan book, I am dumped into a situation and not told anything. This time, we're back at Genabacus, but we're up north, and we're with this very rough civilization. Like, it's very violent, and it's very possessive, and it's, yeah. They also are kind of like giants. Like, they're huge humans, or they're small giants. I don't know which. And we're following kind of this war leader who has something to prove, I guess, and he ends up in a situation where now he's interacting with some people from the Malazan Empire, and that interaction is intriguing. And there have been some, like, history reveals. Like, I'm just curious about what I'm gonna learn. But as of right now, like, the vibes that we're getting were very, like, Northmen and First Law trilogy vibes, which is not my favorite vibes, which is probably what's prevented me from, like, wanting to pick it up, because although interesting things have happened and it's actually not that difficult to read, I haven't really cared about this war leader or this society. Like, I think they make sense, and I think some ways that we are thinking about why they do the violent things that they do in terms of evolution and genetics is interesting? But, like, I'm not compelled at the moment. It's kind of the slowest start to a Malazan book for me so far. And then I'm still reading as my audiobook, The 100 Years War on Palestine, not too much further. I talked about last week the pros and cons for me, so you can check out that video if you want to know more. But I basically just have huge gaps in my knowledge on this part of the world, and this is my first attempt to fill that up. It's looking like I need to pick up lots of nonfiction, though, for several nations in this area, because it's a very intricate, like, part of history. And so as I'm learning about Palestine and Israel, I am also being told things about Lebanon and Egypt. And I'm like, you know, I don't know anything about those parts of history. So I need to start acquiring, you know, book ideas for those sections, because it's like a very part of present day world what happens in that region. Like, just as an American whose, like, tax dollars go over there, and, like, to not have any context is, like, annoying to me at the moment. So acquiring context would be lovely. And then what might I pick up next after Symbiosis? Well, it's between two books. I don't think I'd read both of them. So who knows? It could be my reread of The Stone Sky. I've been really feeling this. I'm really in a mood. So that might happen. But I also have the next Lady Trent book, which I have to get to this month because this is what my Patreon voted for. So both of these are continuations in series, so that feels good. This one's the second book in a series. This is the end of a series, so my completionist brain really likes this because it's the end, and I haven't touched a Broken Earth trilogy book in a minute, and I have touched this book more recently. But I think it'll depend on my mood, because the authorial voices are both strong but different, and it'll just depend what I'm going for. So that's what I might get to next. And now for the little book haul. So these first two are kind of in the same series, and it's an anticipation for next year. We have a second book coming out, and that is Middle Game by Shauna McGuire. If you're new here, I actually adore this book. I don't think I talk about it enough. I love this book. I read this last summer. I read it as my first buddy read with Justine from I Should Read That, and we both really liked this book. And I never bought a copy because I don't like this cover. I have a thing about hands on covers. It's like another reason why I haven't gotten Magic for Liars by Sarah Gailey. But there's a second book coming. I don't know if it's the same characters or anything. I don't care. This cover is really pretty, so I want to get that. So I bought this in hardback because I like to collect things in hardback. But then I saw this book, which is the book within the book from Middle Game. So Middle Game has a children's book referenced, and this is this one, which Shauna McGuire wrote, and I think she wrote it last year and I just never picked it up. And so I'm really excited. I think this is about two kids in different universes who live on the same street. And, like, yes, His Dark Materials has trained me to love this trope. Okay? I am trained. So I'm really excited to probably, and probably won't happen until 2022, but to reread this and this at the same time to, like, provide context and then be prepared for the sequel book. I'm, like, really excited. So these are some new acquisitions. And then I finished Live Shipped recently. I'm sure you haven't heard based off all of the Live Ship content I have on this channel right now, but I found the US hardbacks. And I'm really, really happy that I ended up buying them. So it's really hard to find what I consider good looking copies that are in good condition for this series because it's over 20 years old. And it's never gotten a trade paperback version in the United States. It has a mass market paperback. I don't like trade paperbacks in the UK because the binding's tight. And I also didn't think those covers were, like, pretty enough for that. I mean, they're nice. They're very minimalistic. That's kind of the thing with UK covers, is very artsy, minimalistic stuff. But I found them because I really like, normally I'm hit or miss on the very, like, descriptive art styles of the 80s and 90s and early 2000s covers. Like, you'll notice I never have my sleeves for my Stormlight Archive because I don't know if this is an unpopular opinion, but I don't like those covers. I don't think they're pretty. I mean, I know they're exactly what the team wants them to be. Like, I know it's intentional, but I don't like them. But these ones I really like. So here's Ship of Magic. And so that's Althea and Brashin and the vivacious in the background. It's so pretty. And I love the spine. And the naked hardback's also really nice and has, like, an imprint of maybe Robin's Hobb's signature. Like, this isn't a signed book, but I really like that. So that's the first book in the series, which I really like. This is actually the one that's in the worst condition, but it's still, like, really good condition. And this is probably the book coming up that made me want to buy these covers because it's just so vibrant, and that's Madship. So you have Peregrine and a sea serpent. Sea serpents are a big part of this book. Like, the first page, you meet a sea serpent. And just look at the stress. Oh, it's so pretty. And I love the colors here. Like, it's so good. And then I think, like, color palette wise, this one's the prettiest, but I do still like Mad Ship more. And that's Ship of Destiny, the last one. And here's, I believe that's still Althea on the cover. And I don't know what ship is in the distance, but I really like the sun and the water. So those are the books. And as you probably have seen in my most recent video, they live right here. They're not there right now because I showed them to you guys, but this is where they live now. Yes, they live where my special Cosmere books are, because that's how much I love that series, which is, that should be the only endorsement you need to pick it up, is that I love it as much as books that I spent a lot of money on. I'm just saying. So those are all the book stuff. I did see Shang-Chi this weekend. So good. But I mean, I love Marvel movies, so I actually don't know if you don't want to watch an action movie, if you would like it. Like, I think it's entirely predictable in ways that action movies of this ilk are, but not in an unenjoyable way. Like, I was totally fine with knowing the beats of the stories and seeing the very colorful fight scenes. Ugh. Chef's kiss. And then Come From Away was released on Apple TV, and I'm a musical buff, and I love Come From Away. Come From Away makes me cry every time I listen to it, every time I see it. I started this on Apple TV. I'm just by myself watching it. There's not even a cat around me. The opening scene happens. We don't even play music yet. I'm tearing up. I love Come From Away so much. So if you have access to Apple TV, highly, highly, highly recommend. I will die on my hill that it should have won the Tony for Best Musical the year it came out. You can come at me in the comments if you want to. I will die on this hill. So that's the media I consumed this weekend, and I'm just not going to talk about how the Browns almost beat the Chiefs, but didn't. If you didn't know from Cleveland, I'm sadly a Browns fan because I'm from Cleveland, which means it's hard. It's hard. But that's it for this one. If you want to leave an emoji, feel free. I guess leave something brown or orange because it's fall, and actually those are the colors of the Cleveland Browns. And like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.